That's the most difficult thing for Nigerians to do.
Good afternoon to you, sport fans. You're welcome to another exciting moment where we bring to you sports. And indeed, we are reaching you from the Federal Capital Territory, Abuja. Me and Akira is my name, and today on the show we shall continue with a review of sports in the calendar year 2016. And today we will be talking to the man in charge of sports in the country, Nigeria. Like they say, uneasy lies the head that wears the crown. But then, as we project into the calendar year 2017, we shall take a look at what happened in the year 2016 and hope for a better outing, or the best outing for Nigeria in the calendar year 2017. With me this afternoon is the Honorable Sports Minister, Solomon Dalung. Good afternoon to you, Honorable Sports Minister.
Good afternoon, fellow Nigerians. I think I'm the Minister of Youth and Sports Development for the Republic of Nigeria.
Interesting. Well, let me start by saying Happy New Year to you. And it's good to indeed have this edition in Abuja in your office.
Well, we are grateful to God for his mercies and giving us the opportunity to see the new year.
Well, let's indeed go straight into the business of the day. 2016 was a massive year for the country Nigeria in terms of sporting activities. 2016, we had the biggest sporting games, the Olympics, where countries participated. Nigeria indeed was one of them. We had the Dream Team coming out with a medal after the Olympic Games. We had the 2017 World Cup qualifying games, and then right there and there, it was obvious that Nigeria will not be part of the AFCON tournament that gets underway in a matter of days. There was also the qualifiers for the Under 17 Championship. Nigeria had been the defending champions at the world level, but not there at the African level, meaning that the youth will not be participating at the Under 17 and also at the Under 20 level when it comes to age grade competitions. But then, let's hear from you. Your assessment of sports in the calendar year 2016.
Well, so far, so good. I will start by saying that sports started in 2016 fairly better compared to the preceding years. The basis is we are in a human society, and in a human society, we strive to attain perfection. We struggle to get at the best. In 2016, Nigeria had it better, and Nigeria had some landmark achievements in the outings, whether from the Olympics 2016 in Rio up to the World Cup qualifier, which is ongoing, putting it alongside the African Female Championship and with other good outings. We also had it rough too, judging by our performances in some of the most crucial tournaments, the Under 17 and Under 23, we crashed out. And of course, if you look at the implication on that in football development, it means the generation that will be making the national team in future will be missing out in one of the critical outings which would have contributed in shaping and preparing them for the challenges ahead. If you take the Olympics 2016, I have always been insisting that yes, Nigeria might have not met the expectation of Nigerians, but Olympics is a four-year event.
Okay.
And planning for 4 years, in my own judgment, should encompass the 4 years,
okay,
starting very early. We came on board slightly 8 or 9 months to Olympics. So we inherited an ongoing preparation, which by my assessment too, was not too good enough to have positioned us to challenge other nations of the world at a global gathering like Olympics. But still yet, the little and the modest last-minute efforts and mobilization put by the ministry, which again is a new ministry that was merged in 2015.
Okay.
So at the end of it all, what I consider as the best of our performances in Rio are two or three major things. One, we had for the first time in the history of Olympics an African qualifying to quarterfinals. That had never happened before.
Table tennis,
Haruna Kadri.
Haruna Kadri.
That achievement is historical. It will go a long way in the history of Olympics.
That's it.
The second performance, which I also considered very, very significant, was a young Nigerian coming to Olympics for the first time in canoe and rowing.
That's it.
Chereka Okogu. And she competed to semifinals.
Okay.
And also left an African record of being the first African to qualify to semifinals in that sport. These two things inspired me so much and also gave an impression that with very good preparation, Nigeria will definitely reposition itself. And what also had remained my source of joy is before proceeding to Olympics, I maintained that Nigeria will never come back without a medal. And of course, we returned our name to the medal table, which has been visibly absent previously. So that part of what indeed had also been the success of 2016. Then you come back to take something again that will live with me all my life, is the defeat of Zambia in Zambia
in football
for the first time in the history of Nigeria. Whether we like it or not, this history will live with Nigeria.
Okay, that's massive. I'm supposed to say that you highlighted three important achievements for Nigeria at the Rio 2016 Olympic Games. And then we also had Segun Toriola, who indeed played in his seventh Olympics, and no African had come close to this record except for Segun. But let's take a look at preparation, just like you hinted, which you inherited, the biggest challenge facing sports at this point in time. The dream team got to the Olympics, to Brazil, 6 hours before their first game against Japan. Secondly, Nigerians also complained bitterly about what the athletes were putting on, what they paraded during the traditional opening ceremony of the games. And then we also saw the sports ministry giving out funds to athletes on its own. We've never seen that happen in sports, and we would like to know why. Because it was expected that probably athletes who are participating in the games would go maybe to their federations and then get what they should be getting for participating at the Olympics. But it was a different ball game in Rio. Just looking at all this, what would you say went wrong? Was it beyond the sports ministry, the team getting late to Rio, the dream team 6 hours before the kickoff, and then also what they were putting on, the traditional opening ceremony?
Well, some of the unfortunate circumstances and the palatable developments that characterize the dream team are things that could have been avoidable.
Okay.
But basically, I think it was predicated on the fact that in planning, there were some expectations from the Federation as to certain commitments they had with some of our sponsors. And this failed us. But from our own end as a ministry, we foresaw a situation where the economic downturn globally will definitely have an implication on such commitments. Now, we dutifully warn that it has to be reassessed. That commitment has to be reassessed and tested. But I think we still depended heavily on it. And it took us into what happened. And as I've always been maintaining, it was an unfortunate situation. Our athletes do not deserve that. The athletes cannot be blamed because they have submitted themselves to serve their country. So it's a national service. And Nigeria is expected to also provide and even intervene in situations where they are facing challenges. So the bad experience of the Dream Team is something that personally I have found it quite unpalatable. Our team has to arrive 6 hours, but the ministry and the federal government were involved in a lot of things to try to see how we could have ameliorated the situation. But looking at the distance from where they were, a different country,
Atlanta.
Yes, communication, movement of funds, how to get things even within expressly could not yield positive results. But we thank God that finally we had one of our sponsors, the Delta Airlines, which for their dear love to this country, had earlier committed themselves to move our players. And so when we could not get an aircraft of the choice of our athletes, they came in and rescued the situation. But like I said, these circumstances were avoidable. Then talking about the payment of players directly, well, that is the policy I introduced after reviewing how the relationship between the federations and the athletes. I discovered that oftentimes, after such events, you have numerous complaints coming from the athletes. We have not been paid. We were not fully paid. We were not given this. This was not done. So in order to avoid that, I came up with a policy that the athletes must be paid directly. And one thing, too, that was unique with the method of payment has to do with the number of days. We budgeted for 22 days for the athletes and officials. Now, there are athletes that crash out just 5 days
into
the competition. And in the past, what basically could have happened would have been that they may be paid some 5 or 6 days since they are leaving. But I insisted that the justice of the situation demands that they must be paid their complete 22 days. Whether they crash on the first day or they crash on the second day, they must be paid. Well, the policy or the decision was not too palatable to the federations and their leadership. But I insisted that that should be done, and it was done. To me, I'm happy that we left Rio with no complaints coming from either non-payment or ambition change. We also made sure that tickets of athletes who came on their own were also refunded before we leave. So the administration of Olympics 2016, to me, I'm satisfied, is the best. And if given the opportunity, I will still pay the athletes directly, because I will not pay them through a third party. Let me have somebody whom I can hold accountable in the ministry than going into a federation to look for somebody to be held accountable. And at the end of the day, it will generate some controversies. So these were some of the things we did in Rio.
Well, if you've just tuned in, you're watching the program Sports Edge, the station Galaxy Television, and we're reaching you live from the Federal Capital Territory, Abuja. And then our guest today is the Honorable Minister of Youth and Sports in the country, Nigeria. And then we're reviewing activities of the calendar year 2016. And then definitely we'll also take a look at them expectations in the calendar year 2017. We're still looking at them 2016. Let's look at the medals won by Nigeria. Just the football team and athletics in the past, even when Nigeria does not come back home with so many medals, we get to see our athletes get to the finals of major competitions. But even on the African continent, it has been a challenge. What would you say is responsible, you know, for this situation involving Nigerian sports?
To me and my assessment, what I can attribute to this basically is the paradigm shift in terms of governance in sports and focus. If you check Nigeria as a case study, those institutional sports that are responsible for the production of talents and nurturing over the years have been abandoned. The National Sports Festival, which is an avenue for the showcasing of our national potentials,
yes,
for so many years had not taken place.
Yes.
The National Youth Games, which is also a very critical avenue, platform for much younger talents to be discovered, nurtured, and graduating that to the National Sports Festival, also suffered the same fate for a very long period of time. And yet, we were still talking of going into an international competition. That now took us to relying on foreign-based athletes. Now, the majority of the foreign-based athletes had been recycled for too long, and they were in their facing ages. And of course, the law of diminishing returns, which is an economic theory, would also have to
catch up
with them. So we now fell back on them because we did not prepare from the basis those that could have gone, to compete. Some of these talents we are talking about, there are some very crude talents that if they are exhibited and you read them, they are incredible because they beat some of even the existing records. So all you need to do now is training.
Okay.
So the inability of the country to utilize institutional sports contributed very much in our preparation in 2016.
Well, in your New Year speech, you made mention of the fact that the biggest challenge so far in 2016 for you was the issue of accountability in Nigerian sports, sponsorship in Nigerian sports. You also made mention of the fact that it could have been better. But sadly, the issue of accountability and sponsorship, poor funding, I shouldn't forget. You also stated that. What led to all these?
You see, in Nigeria, we have no reason not to have sponsors. We have so many multinationals doing businesses in Nigeria, but they don't even invest their proceeds in Nigerian sports. They still go out to invest in foreign clubs. And in my review of the basis for some of these things, I discovered that lack of accountability and transparency in sports administration is one of the scary reasons that sponsors had advanced. I have met some sponsors personally one-on-one to solicit their understanding and to woo them to invest in Nigeria. I visited Total. Total invests so much in sports, but they invest in CAF. I commended them for, picking interest in sports. But I also appeal to them that, yes, you may be investing in CAF, but you do business in Nigeria. And majority of the young people who are even disturbing your business prospects are Nigerians. You could do better by investing in CAF and also giving us some portion to provide platform of engagement for these young people so that they allow you to do businesses and they also allow everybody to move freely because they are frustrated. So lack of accountability is that one is critical. The transparency too is a problem because you don't expect somebody to invest in sports and he should not ask questions.
That's it.
If you invite him to invest and then deny him the right of asking questions, you are now asking him to pack and he will not give you a dime. We must be very transparent. If we receive sponsorship, we should publish how we spend those monies. When I was a chairman of my native local government, every month I will invite the people to a people's parley, and I will announce the subvention I receive. At the end of my tenure, local people were able to compute how much I collected, and they look around at the things that were done to, at the end of the day, say, yes, we are satisfied.
Okay.
So transparency and accountability are key components of administration that must determine the confidence of people to invest in it. And leaders, stakeholders in sports administration must imbibe transparency and accountability. Anything shortfall of this, we will just be whiling for people to invest and nobody will come.
Well, if you've just tuned in, it's still Sports Edge, the station Galaxy Television. That's the first segment with the sports minister taking a look at the calendar year 2016. When we come back from this break, because I understand it's time to bring you news on the hour, I'll be asking the sports minister how he has been able to cope with some of the criticisms from the press in the calendar year 2016, and also the Nigeria Football Federation. Football is massive in the country, Nigeria, and everyone wants the Eagles and all of the national teams to be a success. This after the news on the hour.
Many of our more seasoned footballers run for their money. Let's take a look.
Welcome back. Many thanks, Vivian Oguchi. Indeed, you were all smiles in the studio, and definitely we are also all smiles right here in the Federal Capital Territory. If you've just tuned in, you're watching the program Sports Edge, the station Galaxy Television. Before you saw the CAF Awards last night, indeed, just gone by was news on the hour. And I'm still with the Honorable Minister of Youth and Sports, as far as the country Nigeria is concerned, the most populous black nation on planet Earth. We're having a review of sports in the calendar year 2016, and we're projecting into the calendar year 2017. Before when they take a look at what to expect in the year 2017, the sports minister earlier on made mention of the Olympics, and in his own opinion, he said it should be a four-year preparation for any major athlete, and we'll get to find out shortly if Nigeria will indeed have at least 3 to 4 years of preparation for the next Olympic Games. And you know that will be in the year 2020, Tokyo precisely, and then by 2017 it will just be 3 years of preparation. But then let me ask him, the Honorable Sports Minister, in the calendar year 2016, at some point in time you had some challenges with the press, and how were you able to cope with some of the criticisms, you know, from the sports, from the sporting press?
Well, I think criticism basically is a very important tool in shaping leadership. And leaders must be amenable to criticisms. But then, what is very important is that what type of criticisms are we sending out? If a leader is objectively criticized, the intention is to ginger him to do more.
Okay.
But when you have maybe criticism that is subjective, then it tends to distract our focus and attention. And it's also a test of leadership character, because you need to remain consistent if you are convinced about what you are doing. So for me, I think in some places, people have argued that, oh, you have a very bad relationship with the press, and I see it differently.
Okay.
The press is basically discharging its social responsibility. But the public, the court of the public is to judge.
Okay.
Are the criticisms objective or subjective? If they are objective, then they are intended to develop. If they are subjective, then they are intended to destroy. And I think that is my perception of all the criticisms. I've gotten so used to it that when I pick a paper and I do not read anything about Dalung, then I feel I have not done anything. So,
wow.
In fact, I am inspired more on daily basis when I read, oh, sack Dalung, oh, Dalung should go, oh, this. Then it means people are saying, please put up more effort. We want you to do more. That is my understanding of what they are saying. I don't see it from the negative perspective. The only bad thing about criticism is to abandon issues and attack personality.
Mm.
That one now is not good for national development. You can criticize policy, you can attack issues. The intention is to shake it up and weigh it, and then measure it with the paradigm of the ongoing development. But when you deviate to taking personality, then you are demeaning the personality of the leader, and if he doesn't have character strength, he may easily be offended and could lose focus and may not perform well. So I think the press, I don't see them the way people see what they do. There are some of the excesses that went even outside the scope of law that I could have taken steps to seek redress.
Okay.
But again, this government is on a mission.
Okay.
Nigeria is presently undergoing recession. Nigerians are facing a lot of challenges. So some of the excesses, we cannot abandon the responsibility of governance to go on shadow chasing of people who are trying to drag us
backward.
No. But so I neglected all these things. And it is not to mean that I don't know what to do.
Okay.
So, to the press, I think I'm very, very grateful. I'm even looking for today's newspaper to see whether there is another story of Dalung should go. Those are the things that inspire me. So those who have taken maybe professional joy in writing the stories of Dalung must go should know that they are indeed inspiring me to work harder. I've already adapted it and have decoded their messages to mean that.
So in a nutshell, you're saying that probably in the restructuring that could be coming from the presidency, even if Nigerians are saying Dalung should go and the press is saying Dalung should go, it doesn't bother you a bit. You're focused on what you're doing and your assignments.
I am here to serve Nigeria. And I believe God gave me this opportunity to serve. At the time, he wants me to leave. In fact, nobody might even need to make any contribution. He will say, Solomon, leave. And I will leave. I'm a man that believes in destiny. So I am not at all bothered. If God says, Solomon, leave today, I will pick all that belong to me and say, thank you, Lord, for giving me the opportunity to serve my country. He has something for me to do. So I am not at all, bothered whether the cabinet is structured today and Dalung is to go. Indeed, it is the ordained time by God for Dalung to leave. But if it is not the time, nothing will happen.
Well, let's talk serious issues when it comes to money, which indeed is very, very crucial. It is expected and believed that sports is big business across the globe. But from what we see in Nigeria, it's still more of recreational than the business angle. I'll give an example. Recently, there was an allegation from the Federation of International Football Associations, FIFA, that some monies were given to the Football Federation for Football Development, about $1.1 million. And it was an era where our female teams did Africa proud. But sadly, since April 2015, we're in the year 2017 now, these players found it difficult getting bonuses and allowances from the body that controls football, which is the Nigeria Football Federation. They had to come together, carry placards to protest in order to get paid. And if we are looking at paying people for what they've done and they have to protest, that is very petty. And it speaks volume about what they might have been going through. Sport Minister, do you believe that the Football Federation does not have such funds to pay its players? And there are also allegations of monies, about $1.1 million, that the Football Federation cannot duly account for.
Well, let me start by the issue of the Super Falcons. I have stated severally that the situation was unfortunate. When I came in, there was something I discovered and had maintained. You see, the collapse of our reward system in our society is responsible for the way we assess, we attach values and contributions of Nigerians. If our reward system has been functional, I mean, every leader in a position of responsibility should be able to know that this Nigerian deserves justice in the circumstance. So what happened in the case of the Super Falcons, they do not even need to have taken placards. Most especially if you look at the background, is a female football that is yet developing in Africa. You see, that could send a negative impression about our commitment. But indeed, we are committed. Sadly, too, the could have also handled the issue properly and maturely. And I think there was a communication breakdown which infuriated the temperament of the players. I met with them in Cameroon, and these were lovely Nigerians that are patriotic, committed to their country. In fact, in one of the receptions organized to them in Lagos, the captain said, sir, when we saw you in Cameroon, we were happy and we decided that we must bring the cup to Nigeria. People with such mindset couldn't have suddenly turned against their country. Something went wrong. And I later discovered that they had been old since All African Games. And so they no more trust anybody again. Now this goes back to what I said earlier, that even investors are scared of investing because of lack of
trust. Transparency,
accountability. So the players lost faith in all the promises they have been making and decided to protest. Of course, the federal government had to intervene timely. I have, on some occasions, expressed my position that what actually transpired at all had nothing to do with the ministry. The ministry discharged its obligation timeously, but the whole thing had to suffer some form of administrative bottlenecks and not within the purview and the control of the ministry. The memo from our own end left area, and if it was attended to, the monies could have even been ready before the players could have finished the competition. So, but the ministry had to bear the burden and to bear the attack, because of course, just like Joseph of Arimathea, who helped Jesus Christ carry his cross to Golgotha, somebody must take responsibility. And we bear the burden. But we were not in any way at all responsible for what happened to the girls. Now, coming to
FIFA,
the issue of FIFA, I will not want to dive much into it, because I addressed the AGM,
yes,
and drew the attention to their correspondence to my office, that I have taken time to study as a lawyer, and I discovered that there were instances that suggested all is not well with your account, and you must audit your account, and give us a report. And they replied immediately with a communique that the Federation has audited their account and they are comfortable. And in one of the paragraphs, they said the minister was misled. Now, it could be that maybe in trying to read the report misled me. If I'm going to look at what the communique was suggesting. So we have moved to the second stage, because the money was given to NFF, but the withdrawal of developmental fund is to Nigeria.
Yes.
Now, meaning that even my old mother in our village is going to be affected by the sanction because she's a Nigerian.
That's it.
But she was not given the money.
That's it. It was given to a body.
Yes, to a body. So at this point, as a responsible government, definitely we have to save the image of Nigeria. We're not the only Nigerians that will be leaders. Nigeria will live for a very long time. Definitely the image, the integrity of the country is very, very important. So we must go move ahead to try to establish to FIFA that, look, we are a responsible government and we cannot accommodate anything that is shortfall of accountability and transparency. So we'll take steps.
If there is something I noticed under your administration as the sports minister, in the past, when government comes to the Football Federation to ask how monies were spent, they run back to FIFA and say the government has interfered with the running of football in the country, because they say FIFA don't want politics and football to go hand in hand. But it's been a different ballgame entirely. What did you do, or what have you come to understand about this?
Well, the law we have this time now is that it was the center referee that blew the whistle and not the assistant referee. So, for us, it's a good omen. It justified the fact now that the definition of intervention by national federations is sort of a smokescreen to scare governments from looking into their accounts. FIFA gave them money, FIFA came and audited them. When FIFA came for audit, We were not informed. They went. FIFA now wrote a report incriminating them. They now sent the report to us. At the stage which the report of FIFA was released, already Nigeria as a country is into the issue. So if intervention by government means asking questions about the state of accounts of national federation, then FIFA is interfering. But if FIFA is not interfering, then FIFA has set a precedent for national governments to look into the accounts of national federations. This problem is not limited to Nigeria. When we met in the African Union Council of Sports Ministers, almost all African countries. Ministers were complaining the same. In Tanzania, in Kenya, when they returned from
the Olympics,
the officials of NOC had to be bundled and given accommodation in their prisons because the monies they collected for the Olympics, the devil advised them and they couldn't utilize it. So the minister acted. International federations came in, but they insisted. So for us in Nigeria, I want to assure Nigerians that we will have to restore some sanity in terms of administration, the governance structure of sports in Nigeria, and people should be prepared to answer questions on accounts.
My last question, and then that should be in 2 minutes. Sports Minister, it's the calendar year 2017. What should we expect? There are over 32 federations also, as far as sports is concerned in the country.
Well, by the last National Youth Games, which we have to think out of the box, to raise funds, to sponsor it, 15 sports were competed for, and 4,080 athletes from 32 states, including FCT, participated. At the end of the day, we discovered 370 athletes in 13 Olympic sports. Now that is very healthy for our kitty in future preparation for Olympics. We are going to concentrate on further training of these athletes to prepare them for the future. We are also going to alter the way we do things. Before the end of this month, I have directed that all the sporting federations must submit their work plan to the ministry for us to be able to prepare, to know when to begin to ask for intervention. Even if they do not write us, we now intimate them. You give us a plan that you have this. To better write and request for funds if you don't have enough. Now, this will avoid some of these ugly circumstances of athletes coming back without their monies and allowances. We are going to do that. We are going to hold elections of the federation this year.
Okay.
My promise to Nigerians is that anybody who has no business with sports had nothing to do with even coming to contest election.
Okay.
I'm not going to appoint anybody. I'm not going to impose anybody, but anybody who wants to lead the federation must go back to the federation and contest. And then in 2017, we are also going to be more strict with the management of the lean resources we give to the federations. I want to assure Nigerians that in 2017, we will be also implementing some key components of the sports reforms committee report. That's hope awesome. For this year, we're going to open more platforms for the engagement of younger people.
Okay.
The National Lottery Fund has, through the ministry, distributed sporting equipment to primary schools all over the federations. And we hope this will go a long way now to encourage young people in various primary schools to pick interest in sports. So there is hope for Nigerian sports to play a dominant role.
I must say, very big thank you, Honorable Minister of Youth and Sports, Solomon Dalung, for finding out time to talk to us live on the program Sports Edge from the Federal Capital Territory. Indeed, it's been massive, indeed, doing justice to sports this afternoon on Sports Edge. God willing, tomorrow will be here to indeed give you the best as far as sports is concerned. Till I come your way again, me and Akiri, on behalf of the production crew from Abuja, bidding you goodbye.